All right, this is part 5 of linear programming in CHE 531. We were looking at a linear programming problem with a maximization objective function. Just quickly recap. We had three constraints. So I go back to the problem statement. This is from a different book. I already posted on Blackboard. So we are trying to maximize this function subject to three constraints. And we covered up to a point that we got a negative minus or negative 10 coefficients in the last row here. And we said we're going to pick up the most negative coefficients for in the objective function and then select that column and then go along that column and ask or pick up the row corresponding to the smallest non-negative ratio of the right-hand side to the coefficient. Okay, so with this line, we're going to pick up this column because that's the most negative coefficient in this row. And within this column, we're going to pick up this row because 35 by 7 is the smaller or smaller than 16 by 2. Okay, so we're going to pick up that row and right here. Yeah, so if we pivot this one, so we set that to 1. Using row operations, we make all other coefficients along this column to 0. So we're going to have 0 here, 0 here, and 0 here. And there you go. So then we look at, again, the last column, the last row, and still we have a negative coefficient. So the solution to this system, which is 116, is not going to be optimum yet. So we're going to pick up this column because that's the most negative coefficient compared to that one. And within this column, we're going to pick up the smallest non-negative ratio, which is going to be 6 divided by 3 halves, 3 sevenths. Right, okay. So, 6 divided by 3 sevenths is smaller than 16 divided by 2 sevenths. Okay, so we're going to pick up this row and make the coefficient 1, and use row operations, we make other coefficients along this column 0. And you see that this is it. So we're pivoting this row and making the other elements along this column 0. We're gonna get like that, right? So now we look at the last row, which is objective function, and everything here is either positive or zero. There is no negative coefficient. So that means the solution to the system is gonna be optimal, and maximum function is gonna be 132. Okay. You can also solve for the basic variables by setting the non-basic ones to 0. In this case, the non-basic ones are S2 and S3, and the basic ones is going to be or they're going to be X1, X2, and S1. Okay, so we find those using three equations, three unknowns. There's going to be 15, 12, and 14. We plug them into the objective function and we get 132, which is right here. So we knew this even before substituting all the non-basic variables and basic variables into the system. All right, so here's the pictorial presentation on what has been done. So we started from, the first row we found initially z was 0, right? So if you go back all the way to the solutions right here, the first solution we found was z equal to 0 by setting the non-basic ones to 0. And we found that basic ones are also, 11, 27, and 90, but we put all of these, x1 to s3 into the objective function. We found the objective function is 0. So the 0 point we found initially is actually the first corner of this polygon. The second solution we found, if you remember, with x1 equals 0 and x2 equals 11, was 66, which is this point or this boundary point of the polygon. The next solution we found was 5 and 16 for x1 and x2. And the z corresponding to that was 116, which is this point. And then the last point we found was 15 and 12 for x1 and x2. The corresponding z was 132, which is this point. And we found that that's the maximum. So we're not going to test the other corner because we know that all the coefficients along the last row was positive or non-negative. So the solution we found should be optimal, and we know that the linear programming has a unique solution, and using the simplex method, this should be the only solution. Okay, so we're now going to test the last corner, and solution is going to be 132. So this is simplex method. And there are a couple more examples in this book. I really recommend going over them and make sure you know all the steps. So in the next few minutes, I'd like to spend some time to look at the MATLAB built-in function and see how we can solve these problems using MATLAB. All right, so switching to MATLAB. So here is the first example. Let's say we want to maximize this this objective function. Let me just uncomment them. Okay, so to maximize this, subject to the constraint. I have 1, 2, 3, 6 constraints here. And this is objective function we want to basically optimize. Okay, so how we can do this in MATLAB? So this is how we write in MATLAB. First, we have to construct the A matrix, which is just the coefficients for, well, sorry, I think someone told me that you need to see bigger font here, so I just forget that. Let me just increase it to maybe 18. All right. There you go. This is too big, but that's okay. Okay, so all we do for now, yeah, it's actually really too big. So let me make it 16, or maybe 14. All right, let's see, hopefully 14 is a bit better. Okay, so now all we do in MATLAB is we just put the coefficients for the non-basic variables. Remember, we had x1 and x2. In MATLAB, we do not deal with s1, s2, all those slack variables and so forth. We only put the coefficients for the non-basic ones, the x1 and x2 only. So here's the coefficient for x1. Here's the coefficient for x2 for these 6 constraints. Now, we create another vector called b, which is the coefficients or the numbers or values for the right-hand side. So 2, 1, 2, 1, minus 1, 2. Put them in a row in column, in vector b. So now I have my a, I have my b, and then in F, I construct a vector of just the coefficients for the variables in the objective function, which is minus 1 here and minus 1/3 here. So it's minus 1 and minus 1/3. And just go ahead and call the function linprog, which means linear programming, giving the F first, and then A, and then B. So with these three, we should be able to solve for X. Let's try that. Okay, so I got an error. Line 11. Yes, I'm sorry. These actually should become, these are just comments. I forgot. Yeah, MATLAB doesn't need to know all these inequalities. MATLAB understands them by just looking at the A matrix. And again, the inequalities should be in less than or equal to. Okay, if you have a bigger than or equal to, you have to multiply by a negative sign. An objective function is supposed to be maximization. If you want to minimize something, you have to multiply the objective function by another negative sign. All right, so let's do this. And this is it. So the solution is going to be 0.6 and 1.3 for x1. So this is going to be x1, this is going to be x2. And what is the value of f? Let's see if I type f here, what do I get? Okay. So if you want to get the f out, there's another option for it. Let me see. If I have here, yes. We have to get the F eval. So if you want to get the F out, then we have to write it this way. X, F eval, and then whatever comes next, which we don't care. And that's equal to linprog of AB, something like that. Okay, let me just run this code one more time. And the f is going to be minus 1. So that's the maximum that f can take. And yes, I think this is it. Okay. So just want to make sure that MATLAB is maximized. Oh, I'm sorry, actually, the MATLAB function is a bit weird. So MATLAB is minimizing the objective function. It's a bit different than the standard form. Well, it doesn't really matter because we can just change every minimization to maximization and vice versa. So so again, MATLAB is minimizing the objective function subject to inequality constraints, with inequalities being less than or equal to. Okay, just wanted to make sure that I'm telling you the right thing. Okay, So back to this problem. Now I know how to get x and how to get the f out of the linearization after out of this linear programming problem. The second example, I think I have some time to go over, is what if we have equalities as well as inequalities? Okay, suppose at the, other than the inequalities that I have also some equality constraints. Okay, in this case, let's say I have x1 plus 1/4 x2, okay, is equal to 1/2. So again, this x1 plus 1/4 x2 is equal to 1/2. With this equality, how can I go and solve the problem? So for that, you create two other matrices, A equal and B equal, okay, and then put them in the last two elements of the line that you call the function, like exactly this that I have here. So let me comment out these ones. Yeah, so this is example two. Now what I'm adding is this equality constraint. Okay, I'm adding this to the system, and by adding it, I have to create an A equal, B equal, and put them in the last two elements of the function we call. And this time, if you go ahead and solve it, you get a different solution, of course, because you have an equality constraint. Just to make sure, this structure should satisfy the equality. 0 and 2, you plug them in here, you see it's 1/2. Fine. So now we added the equality. The next thing we're going to add to our example is we're going to have some dual bounds. So before we only had less than or equal to bounds. Imagine I'm going to have now bigger than or equal to bounds, like these two. So how should we go about doing this? Well, we're going to add two more vectors, lower bound and upper bound. Lower bound, the first column, gives you the lower bound on x1 and lower bound on x2. For upper bound, the first column gives you the lower bound on x1, the second column gives you, so the upper bound. The first element gives you the upper bound for x1, and the second column gives you the upper bound for x2. Okay, so these are all lower bounds for x1 and x2. This is all upper bound for x1 and x2. Then they come as the last element of the call function. So if I uncomment them and rerun the example, and there you go. So you get different solutions, of course, but this takes into account both lower bound and upper bound for x1 and x2. All right, so now let's see what else we can add to our linearization or the linear programming problem. So this time, we're going to choose the algorithm. So far, I think the algorithm was dual simplex, but there are other algorithms that we didn't cover in this class, and we're not going to cover in class because it's out of the scope of the class. But for now, you know that there is another option for algorithm, and maybe later in the course, if you talk about other optimization problems, you should be able to go and change the algorithm according to what we learn, and basically solve the same, linear programming problem with a different algorithm. But for now, all we do is dual simplex, which is very similar to simplex. And so the algorithm comes as options, and the options go into the last element. But before I actually put the options, you have to put this empty matrix in there. And for some reason, if you don't do that, you get an error. And that takes, some time. Well, actually, it took some time for me to figure out that there has to be an empty matrix right here. So anyways, with this option, you can also set the algorithm. And if you want to know other algorithms, I suggest go to MATLAB Help and take Linear Prog or LinProg and see other options in there. Okay, so let me comment this out. And then the last example, I think, well, two more examples. This one actually, now you can get the output, right? You can get the function value as well as the x or the optimized value for the z and the x. You can also know whether it converged or diverged during optimization and other stuff. So stay tuned for the next part in linear programming using MATLAB built-in function. Thank you so much for watching.